can, but you are pretending to believe that somebody can die, decompose, and then one day some trumpet will sound somewhere and the dead in Christ shall rise. You may be living in a world of imagination. I tell you, if you can't believe in God working today, you cannot believe in the things of the last days. The sky opening and you seeing Jesus standing at the right hand of the throne of God is possible. The thing about God is you can easily retire from believing God and be sitting in church and you don't know you've lost your faith. I believe in medical practice. I believe in medication. I believe in the work of doctors. But when doctors are performing at that level, and pharmacists are performing at that level, and science is performing at that level, it means God must perform at this other level, which is above what the scientists can do. May God give you a sign where there will be something you could easily do yourself. But you say, God, I want to stand still and I want to see the salvation of the Lord. And you see the Lord perform it. Maybe it was the last time I came here. I spoke to us about the word of God. And I told you that we will have to speak the word of God more than ever before. When I got born again in 1980, the word of God was supreme. Everybody wanted to speak the word. These days, people speak their mind. They say what they think. When you go to Facebook, there is something they ask, what's on your mind? So anything that is on your mind, whether it makes sense or is nonsense, you write it down. But I believe that after today, instead of saying what is on your mind, you will say, what does the Lord say? May you exchange what's on your mind with a thus saith the Lord. That we will speak the word of God and know what is on your mind, because the thing that is on your mind may look sensible, but it's not spiritual. God said, my ways are not your ways, my thoughts are not your thoughts. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. So the word of God, thus saith the Lord. What is God saying? What's God say? And this word of God can be likened to so many things. You can liken the word of God to honey. You can liken the word of God to water. You can liken the word of God to a hammer. You can liken the word of God to a sword. But this morning, I want to liken the word of God to light. Everybody say light. And when I decided to do light, I was thinking about the name of this ministry, Guiding Light Assembly. I don't know what the guiding light is, whether the guiding light is the believer or the guiding light is the word of God. But whichever way you look at it, I pray that today you will get supernatural illumination and that the light of God's word will touch your life. The Bible said in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. Anytime the Spirit of God is moving, take advantage of the moving of the Spirit of God and speak the word. When you speak the word of God in the midst of darkness, light appears. And I can tell you, there is a lot of darkness, chaos in our world today. And only the word of God can deal with it. The amount of wickedness and evil in our world is on the ascendancy. Only the word of God can deal with it. May God give us people that have the boldness to declare the word of God. And when I speak about the word of God, I'm not just talking about the ability to memorize and quote scriptures. The word of God is, what is God saying? What are the thoughts of God? What is God saying about a situation? That is what brings light. The amount of wickedness we are dealing with in our world today, until we go back to the word of God, many of us will perish. I was doing a meeting recently in the capital of Ghana. I had a word of knowledge about people whose arms God was healing because there was a deformity in the right arm. A woman came and stood in front of me with a baby of about maybe 1 year old. I looked at the baby, I looked at the mother. Then the Lord gave me a word. I told the woman, I said, woman, you are the same person the forces of witchcraft passed the witchcraft through to torment this child. Yet you are standing here saying you want the child to be healed. As soon as I said that, the woman's countenance changed. She began to look like a beast and attempted to attack me in public. I mean, we rebuke the spirit and cast out the demon. Yet, you will see this woman walking about and you think, this is a caring woman who wants the child to be healed. But she is the one, she's the agent, all the spirits are passing through to trouble the life of the child. I just pray that today you will get illumination. Because the earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Bible said, God said, until you know what God is saying, darkness will continue to persist in your life. Apart from illumination, another thing the word of God as light does is that it is a creative agent, an agent of creation. In the beginning was the word was with God, and that word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of man, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and that word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. In other words, the word of God is the creative force that creates everything. It creates everything. If the word of God created the material world, the mountains and the seas and the oceans, then I begin to understand that the word of God can create a house for you. I could even hear an amen. Man of God, you mean I can just speak the word of God and a house will appear? That's exactly what I'm talking about. You can speak the word, and when they ask you finally, how did you get this house? You cannot explain. For example, if an auditing group, maybe a group of investigators, were sent to me in Borgatanga, and I'm told that the house I live in, I should produce receipts. I should justify how I built that house. I'll just tell them, bring the handcuffs. I hire no lawyer. Send me to jail. Because you know what? There is no way I can defend even 10% of how we are in that house. The house is a product of a miracle because you speak the word and you don't know how it will happen. I pray that God will give somebody a miracle like that. I remember a woman who came into our ministry last year, November. I picked up the woman. She came to the front of the church. Very poor woman, homeless woman. One of these days, I may give some of the clips to your technical so that they put it on the screen for you to see. This woman came last year, November, homeless. She has no house. She's a beggar in a market and does some little work. And the work pays about less than $1 every 3 days. She came into the church looking very wretched. I picked her up. I raised an offering for her. By the following day, we had changed the work she was doing, put her on remittance. We investigated, went to a village. We realized she was a widow. Her husband was dead. Her three children were dead. Her mother was dead. The person who brought us here into our church had died. And the woman was just walking about, and they had thrown her out of the family house because they said she was a witch. I gave my people a program. I said 7 people, and they came in front of me. I said, build a house for this woman within the next 1.5 months, because we were in the second week of November. And I said, by Christmas, I want to see this woman in her own house. And true to the word, by Christmas last year, this woman was in a 2-bedroom house with everything of her own. I will show you the picture of this thing later. I'm prophesying on somebody's life. You are getting too many things through hard work. I believe in hard work, but I believe in miracles and signs and wonders. The Bible said every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, and it comes from the Father of lights, in whom is no variableness or shadow of turning. If God can create mountains, I believe he can create a house. If God can create oceans, I believe he can do that little thing you are expecting him to do. May God cease being a theoretical God to you, and may he be a practical living God to you. The Bible said he that cometh to him must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So the Bible said all things were made by him, and that is the word. In him was life. It means if you don't have the word of God, you are really not living. You may look like you are alive, but you are not. Said in him was life. So the word of God is a creative force. The word of God is the giver of life. Then the word of God gives direction. Everybody say direction. Come on, shout it again, direction. Every day I come across confused people. People who don't know what they're about in life. But the word of God gives direction. I don't know whether Pastor Wale saw this when he was doing Guiding Light Assembly. I couldn't help but keep thinking about you when I was preparing this one. Look at that. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well to take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came in the old time not by the will of man, but holy men of God were moved by the Holy Ghost. So holy men of God were moved by God, and they spoke the word of prophecy. And the Bible said we should take heed to that word of prophecy, as unto a light that shines in the dark place. The word of God gives you direction. Direction. And it's the word of God. And the Bible said holy men were moved. Everybody say holy men were moved. And I want you to use a certain word. Say specialists were moved. Now, I know that people, when it comes to aeroplanes, all of us, how many of you are pilots in this building? Lift up your hand. Pilot. You're a pilot. Pilot. I'm not seeing a hand. How many of you are engineers? Engineer. Lift up your hand. Okay. How many of you are medical officers? Medical officers. So you see that few hands are going up. But let me ask a question. How many of you have ever taken a medication, though it was not prescribed by a doctor? Lift up your hand. You are not a doctor, but you do, what do they call that thing? Self-medication. It is the same way when it comes to the word of God. Many of us are doing self-medication and self-prescription, and we are destroying ourselves. The Bible said no scripture is of private interpretation. because holy men of God were moved to write it. The people who wrote the scriptures were not some Okada gra-gra people who sit in Okada from here and go there, 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 and then they wrote the scriptures. No, they were holy men that were separated to write it. Look at Paul. Paul, after conversion, went into the deserts of Arabia for 3 years to be taught by Jesus before he even showed himself to the apostles. And after that, another 14 years of serious tuition. So Paul cannot write the scriptures, moved by the Holy Ghost, and some reckless person will just interpret it. Same with Peter. Moses was on the mountain with God for 40 days and 40 nights. After breaking the commandments, he went up for another 40 days and 40 nights. Listen, one day you may see a book I've written. It's called The Man of God. I was going with my wife to Toronto in the month of May. We sat in the plane from England flying to Toronto. And the Lord told me, the man of God, the man of God. I took my phone and I began to type the notes, the man of God. I started writing. The mystery of the man of God, the ministry of the man of God, the mandate of the man of God, the mission of the man of God, the misery of the man of God. I began to write the maintenance of the man of God, the mountain of the man of God. The thing finally concluded on the madness of the man of God. I typed this thing on my phone from London to Toronto without break. By the time I'm moved like that by the Holy Ghost to type out these things, when I finish writing the book, another person will eat a bar and a foriro for the whole day and try to interpret what I have written. So I was moved by the Spirit to write it. The person is moved by a bar to disagree with me. Just like I'm preaching today. I have prayed through the night. I couldn't sleep for a lot of the night yesterday because I see a revival in this building. Amen. Listen, many of you in the next 3 days, God will mess you up completely. Because you know what he's going to do? He's going to break you down and reassemble you and produce a new person out of your life. I can promise you something by the grace of God. In 3 days, you'll be more spiritual than you've ever been before. Your eyes will open to see things you've never seen before. You will move in the Holy Ghost like you've never moved before. You know what? Some of you are going to pray until your wife is shocked. You are going to worship until your husband is shocked. You are going to pray until your children think something is wrong with you. And you are going to pray until your parents think you have a mental problem. I typed it. I could feel the movement. I got back home, and for the whole of the month of June, I preached in our church a message I called The Man of God. Because what the Lord told me is that there is a deception in the world. The believers think that because we are all children of God and all of us have the Holy Ghost, everybody is a man of God and everybody is a woman of God. People, we are all children of God, but not everybody is a man of God or a woman of God. The Bible said he gave some, not all. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers. And I pray that you would take heed unto the word of prophecy. We had a meeting in Accra. A prophet called a woman and said, "Madam, Brother Isud has written a book. It is called Bread from Baal Shalisha. I wrote a book called Bread from Baal Shalisha. He said, go and buy thousands of that book and distribute to people at random, and God will bring bread into your life. Later on, my books people realized that particular title was finished. So they got back to the prophet and they said, "Prophet, that book is finished. Should we get another title of brotherhood? Because by the grace of God, I've written 83 books. All were typed by myself. So there are other titles there they could have gone for. Thousands to this room." The prophet told them, "No, I didn't say any book of Brother Eastwood. I said bread from Baal Shalisha. So if it is finished, let the woman pay for the printing of thousands of that book and distribute it." So I gave them the go ahead. I said, "Go ahead and produce the thousands for this woman to do what the Lord has told her to do." Because I believe in the word of prophecy. A man of God, that prophet, I believe in the word that comes out of his mouth. He's called Ajimai Prempe. He came to our church the other day in the month of, is it April? And he was ministering and picked up my cousin. My niece. My sister lives in another city called Tamale. This man doesn't know my niece from anywhere. Even our church members don't know her. Called her and said, "Your parents live in Tamale." I said, that's correct. That one's correct. Then he said, "Your grandfather was an ex-soldier." I said, "That one too. This one is correct. Spot on." Then she said, "There is a great man in your family." I assumed I'm the great man. So that one too is correct. Then he added the third one that blew me away. He said, "You have an auntie called Veronica. And I really have a sister called Veronica. So over there, you know, I just love the word of God. This thing just blew me away. I just got up. I looked at him. I said, you know what? I'm giving you this church as a gift. Keep it. I'm out of here." And I walked out of the building. But I was very excited. I said, can the word of God come so close, so real? I pray that this week, from today into Monday, into Tuesday, please relax. You have toiled all night and you've taken nothing. Nevertheless, at the word of God, you will let down the net. I was coming to Lagos. For the first time in my life, Pastor Wale, I have never come to Nigeria and I'm carrying naira, like maybe 100,000 naira. No, I may come with some dollars, but not naira. But I think people around the world have heard that the economy of Nigeria is not good at all. So a friend of mine heard I was coming, and he came to my house with a bag full of money. He put one down, bam, 500,000 naira, bam, 500,000 naira, bam, 500,000 naira. I said, "My friend, where am I going with all this? I'm going for just 3 days. I don't need so much money." Then he told me, he said, no. He hears that the Nigerian money has spoiled. The currency has gone down. So all this money he's giving me is just about $6,000 or five. I don't know how much 1.5 or 1.7 million will be. But the money he gave me is about 1.5, 1.6, 1.7 million naira. And I'm sitting with this money. I don't know what to do with it because I don't have intention to spend that amount of naira when I'm here. But the thing is millions, plenty. And I'm sure there are some of you, sometimes you carry them in Ghana must go. You don't know where to pass with them. Your businesses are getting frustrated. The economy is frustrating you. So God brought me here. And I have preached from this speak the word in this building before. But God said, go and repeat it. Send my people back to the word. When there was famine in Samaria, it was a prophet who stood at the gate and said, tomorrow, about this time, I pray somebody is about to receive a miracle, a major financial move of God in your life. This is the time when your finances will be the best. And I prophesy on somebody's life by the grace of God and God's favor. Between between now and the end of December, may you enter a financial season like you have never entered before. And you are saying, Pastor, this thing cannot be. It's not possible. I hear the words of Peter. We have toiled all night and we have taken nothing. But Peter added, nevertheless, at thy word, we will let down the net. Receive it. It is called the word of God. He said, wherefore you do well that you take heed. Everybody say that you do well to take heed. Do well to take heed, because if you are not careful, you can reject it. This word of God brings deliverance. The Bible said in the book of Psalm 107, the verse number 20, he sent forth his word. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from all their destructions. He sent his word, healed them and delivered them from all their destructions. And the word word over here is the Hebrew word dabar. Everybody say dabar. Come on, say dabar. Dabar is the word of God here. And dabar is the matter spoken of. Pastor Wale deals with the matter of the heart. This is the matter spoken of. I remember when we were students, they would give a question. Somebody will answer the question and write, fill up all the paper, and receive supplementary sheets. When the results come, the person has 30%, or the person has an E or F. Then it's like, look, I wrote copious answers. The thing is, you were writing, but you were not dealing with the heart of the matter. You were not dealing with the matter spoken of. Ladies and gentlemen, many of you are working very hard in life, but the thing is, you have deviated completely. You are dealing with something that is not the issue. Look at Martha. Martha was very, very busy working hard. And she rather went to Jesus to complain. Sir, I'm working hard. My sister is not helping me. And Jesus said, only one thing is needful. And Mary has taking that, and nobody would take that from Mary. The word is the most important thing. Mary has taken the word. I just pray that today, tomorrow evening, Tuesday, stop everything you are doing. I'm too busy. I had to go to the office. The word of God and the work of God and coming to church, these 3 days is more important than the work you are doing. Because you know what? In the 3 days, you will find something you cannot find in 30 days. In the 3 days, you will find something you cannot find in 3 years. In the 3 days, you will find something you cannot find in 30 years. In the 3 days, you will find something which even if you were made a magician, you cannot discover within 30 years. He sent forth his Dabba or Dava. Dava. And healed them. That word Dava also means answer. It also means commandment. And it means a thought. But the devil has a trick. Paul said, if our gospel be hid, it is hidden to them that are lost, in the whom the word of God has blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Man of God, the devil has a way of hiding the truth from people. I went to a church to preach, and hear what the pastor told me. The pastor told me, he said, Brother Eastwood, I think he knew the way I operate. And he knew that spiritually I may go wild No, sometimes I go wild. I go wild. Last Friday, I went wild. Wild. One day of the meeting, I told the people, I want you to bring me new clothing. I will get to that soon. I said the following day, everybody bring new clothing to church. I'll pray over them. You wear it. Something new will start in your life. One of the days, they were holding anointing oil. I said, bring your own anointing oil. They were holding it. Listen, I have never done this in my life. Because I don't believe in presumptuously telling people to put anointing oil in their mouth. I'm a pharmacist. And I understand what it means for people to put substance in their mouth. But that day, the Lord told me, he said, let everybody take their own anointing oil. And let them take just a little at the tip of their finger and touch their tongue. When they did, I said, 20 seconds from now, some of you will start coughing. Some will be vomiting. Some will feel fire in their mouth. You should see the room, the reaction. Some were throwing up. Others were coughing. People that were following us online were reacting overseas, abroad, even before I said what was going to happen. Deliverances were taking place. Demons were being cast out. I was following the word of God. I was following the word of God. But you know, people, whenever the Lord is moving and things like that are happening, people say, no, it's not the word of God. Because you see, people think the word of God is just a mental thing. The word of God is not a mental thing. The word of God is, what is God saying? I remember at my mother's funeral, Pastor Wally, my mother's funeral. I'm sitting there and the Lord told me, get up and start running. My mother's funeral, I should get up, start running. And people will say what? That the man is a bad man. I said, God, this one, no. I'm not going to run. I refuse to run. I sat down. I asked the Lord, why should I run? In public, they'll say I'm mad. But you see, Zacchaeus ran and climbed a tree. And it was God who made him run. Brother Eastwood is sitting there feeling too big to run. And you know there are some kind of word of God. Some of us who are very big, we don't experience it. No, I'm telling you, if I say the Holy Ghost is about to move here, Spirit of God is about to do something here, I can guarantee you that most of the people who fly first class in plane, they are not likely to feel anything. No, they'll take a first class position when the Holy Ghost is moving. Really? Are they faking it or is it real? That is first class position. I refuse to run. The Lord told me, he said, when I told you to run, if you are run on that day, everything about your life will be very fast. You will build fast. You will succeed fast. You will break through fast. But because you didn't run, things will be slow. After some years, I see things in my life over the past, I think mom passed about 3-4 years ago. 4 years ago, thereabout. Doc, things are very fast for me, relatively, before her passing. My wife sometimes looked at me and she said, if you had known, you should have run. Because you didn't even run and look at how fast things are for us. If you had run. And I'm looking at it and I'm saying, God, bring me another opportunity. This one, I won't only run, I will fly. I will jump, but it's over. God can sometimes tell you to do some crazy things. I remember recently we were in England, my wife and I told her, I said, I want to go down and I want to be praying on the streets before you pick me up for church on Sunday. I went out in my nice suit. I'm walking the streets around the Excel, that Crown Plaza Hotel that is there. I'm just walking down there and I'm just speaking in tongues and I'm shouting. And the white people who have come to take that cable car, the tourists, they stopped and they were looking at me. A black man walking about in suit screaming. I'm sure they thought some marijuana or something is touching my brain. And I'm just walking back. Then I go, hey, Kerry Kabaja. They were looking at me. Before I realized, a black man from the other side of the road jumped through the cars, was skipping through traffic, came and stood in front of me. He said, Reverend Eastwood, I know you from Ghana. Pray for me right now. I looked at him, I shouted, I said, you have come at the right time because I'm at my craziest best. I feel charged and I'm looking for somebody to put my hands on the person. You have come at the right time. I laid hands on the guy and prayed for him. My wife was approaching me. The rest of the people were looking at me. I said, I don't care. Listen, may you learn to follow God. One day I entered a restaurant to eat with my wife again in London. And I'm picking London because I like that community. They are very, very British. I enter a restaurant to eat, big restaurant. Everybody eat what you can. I sat there, picked up the food. I told my wife, I said, I feel like shouting. She said, here. I said, yeah. Everybody sitting down. I went, bye. They turned around. They were like, I like the way you are staring at me. Thank God your husband is not into that. I was doing a meeting in Accra, Ghana. A woman had attended the meeting from Nigeria. I called her forward. She was wearing this big ashoke. The Lord said, remove it and hit her with it. A woman's ashoke. You don't know what is under. Because these women, sometimes, they cover many things with them. I removed it from the head. I hit her with the thing. This one is not falling under the power. This one is being punched by the power. I punched her with it. She went on the ground. I looked at her. I said, the yoke is broken. The woman came back to Lagos. Then she wrote a testimony to me. She said, when I came back, after 3 days, I felt like pushing something out of my belly. I went into the bathroom, and when I pushed, at that time she was running a hotel. The hotel was collapsing. Her marriage was going down. She said, I pushed, and lo and behold, the hand of a human being cut from the wrist came out of me. Somebody said, how did it enter there? I don't know, but I know how it came out. That the power of God removed that thing from the woman's body. I pray when God speaks to you, may you learn to understand. You see, many times when we talk about this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but that thou shalt meditate day and day and night, people will tell you, show me in the Bible where it is written. The only truth about the matter is that it is written in many, many places, only you are refusing to see it. You are refusing to see. So when it comes to the word of God, and I tell you, give me your necklace. So madam, give me your necklace. Thank you. If I tell her, give me this, and I'll pray over it for you, and God will change the chemistry, your marriage, your ministry, your business. Somebody will say, but can't he prophesy without using the woman's necklace? Is it not embarrassing to receive a woman's necklace? Can't he prophesy without that? It's just like asking the prophet Agabus. The Bible said around Antioch, people were dead, believers gathered, and a certain prophet came by the name of Agabus and took a belt, and the belt belonged to Paul. And I'm holding somebody's necklace.
The belt
belonged to Paul.
And he said, the owner of this belt,
so shall the Jews do to him in Jerusalem. And the Bible said the people who could not understand the word of God, and the word of God was hidden to them. They were blinded and they couldn't see the word. They began to cry. And Paul, who understood the scripture, said, why are you weeping and crying to break my heart? I am not only willing to be punished and persecuted in Jerusalem, but I'm willing to die. You see, they were going to prophesy, but they used that belt as a point of contact. Yesterday, a couple visited me. I was very tired, and I took my legs, and I put my legs on the sofa. When I put the legs on the sofa, my feet touched the handbag of the woman. She removed it. In her mind, hey, I shouldn't disturb the man of God's feet. I said, woman, if you knew the feet that were touching your bag, you will carry your whole dress and put it on the feet. Madam, please don't walk in ignorance. Leave the bag exactly where it is. I pray. Karabasha. Madam, you will see what will take place after this. Anybody who is clapping, the thing is yours. And anybody who adds a shout to that clap, the thing is yours. One day, the prophet Elisha was carrying double the spirit that was on Elijah. He came over the river Jordan, and my Bible said, after he came across, the people of Jericho came to him and they said, sir, the situation of this land is pleasant, but the waters are not and the ground is barren. The man of God said, go and bring me a new cruse and put salt in it. They brought a new cruse, they put salt in it. He went on the waters of Jericho and began to sprinkle the salt on the waters. And he said, the waters of Jericho are healed. And the barrenness is taken from the land. A new cruse in which had never been used, put salt in it. Tomorrow night, can anybody here respond to a prophetic direction? A miraculous direction. Last week, when we were doing the meeting in Accra, Ghana, the Lord told us, he said, bring a new dress to church. Let them bring new clothing to church. I will pray over it. And then you take it away. I said, Lord, I've never done this before. All my life as a preacher, I've never told people, bring a new dress to church. That day, I had ironed the white shirt I was going to wear. I went and took a brand new shirt I had never worn. And I gave it to my wife and I said, they should change. I took that shirt to church with all the people. I carried a new shirt myself. I prayed over it and I said, I'm going to wear it on that night. That night, I took my shirt. Everybody prayed over their shirt or their handkerchief or their whatever. I went home, they ironed that shirt for me. I wore it on the Friday night. When I finished the service, I was worshiping. I went down under the power. It has never happened to me like that in that city. Sometimes it happens to me in Bogatanga, but not in Accra. They carried me. My wife told me later, they carried you full length. And you can imagine this anaconda. Carried full length. My height and length is what I'm calling anaconda. They carried me. Took me, I prophesied. I spoke about the Messiah. I ministered for another 1 hour in the upper room there. The place was full of people. Some were collapsing. Others were crying. The power of God was there. You know, I believe that when I brought that shirt and prayed, and I said, God, do something new in my life. Something else took place in my ministry. I told my wife from Accra, I said, I have not recovered. I am still under that anointing. And God brought me to this church. And I pray in the name of Jesus, may you
revival. May you receive a revival. Tomorrow, if you are tired of the things that are happening in your life and you want something new, I have the permission of the Holy Ghost to permit you to bring something new to church tomorrow. It can be a new ashoke, a new shawl, a new shirt, a new handkerchief, a new pair of shoes, a new something. It can even be a new watch. You are not bringing it as an offering. You are bringing it, I will pray over it, release you, you will take it home. And when you take it home, the next time you put it on your body, something new will be taking place in your life. Something will start changing. An anointing will start coming upon your life. Can I hear you shout an amen? Amen. You see, the word of the prophecy is that the waters are healed. The word of the prophecy is that the ground is healed. But the man of God used the salt and used the cruise, which had never been used, a new cruise. Jesus Christ is about to speak the word of God for a deaf man with hearing impediment and speech impediment to be healed. The Bible said Jesus took saliva and touched the tongue of the man before he said, "Ephphatha, be open." The prophetic gesture is the application of the saliva. Some of you get offended. Why do they do that? It is still less than saliva. If I spit right now, this church will reduce by half before I finish spitting. I mean, people say, if I was alive in the days of Jesus, I would have believed the word of God, but these days I can't believe this man of God. If you were alive in the days of Jesus, your case would be worse. Fill the water pots with water, and after that, the water was turned into wine. Why couldn't he do that miracle by stopping even the first wine from finishing? Why would he be converting water into wine? I pray. May God speak to somebody. We are getting right.